every sport has its hierarchy of events, with one championship or tournament standing out as the most exceptional. In the world of board riding, Surferbout has claimed this singular distinction every year and has guarded its reputation jealously ever since its inception in 1974. Each time it's held, this prestigious contest rewrites the record books in terms of prize money offered and the number of surfers involved. It has become the showpiece of international surfing. In the early days of this sport, when its pioneers had to contend with unwieldy planks that were the forerunners of today's scientifically designed boards, there were few who could have foreseen the remarkable development and surprising growth that the sport was to undergo.
These are the beaches of Australia, washed by four oceans, stretching like a giant golden necklace round 7,000 miles of her coastline. Boards and skis provide plenty of thrills. Lifesavers use them to patrol beyond the last line of breakers. But for the surfer, the board has only one use. It's the ultimate in riding the waves, a thrilling challenge to skill and nerve.
Years old Mitch Farrelly displaying the skill that made him king of the boards.
Today there are hundreds of thousands of surfers around the world, and the most outstanding exponents are invariably on show during Surferbout. The contest has undergone a remarkable evolution in its nine-year history, from the time when Michael Peterson, something of a cult figure in his heyday, claimed the first Surferbout title and pocketed the sport's richest purse of $3,000, the spoils have now grown to over $70,000. The winner of Surferbout 82 can earn a full year's salary in 3 or 4 days, $20,000 in cash, and a four-wheel drive Toyota Blizzard worth an additional $10,000. Little wonder there are so many anxious to share in Surferbout's pot of gold. By the time the first board is waxed for the opening heat, the contest officials have sifted through more than 350 applications from all over the world. By a simple process of elimination, that number is narrowed down to 128, who must then progress through the rigorous lightning bolt trials to qualify for 14 vacant spots in the main event. Lightning Bolt Trials have earned the reputation as the toughest elimination series in the world of pro surfing. They also produce some of the most radical surfing of the year. The series of 82 develops into a virtual symphony on the waves. outstanding virtuoso in this extravaganza is a young newcomer to the ranks of pro surfing, Wes Lane, from the east coast of America, who survives a showdown in the final against Maroubra's Greg Day. His success is further evidence of the very real effort being made by the mainland Americans to reclaim the prestige they once enjoyed on the international contest scene. The 32 finalists for Surfabout meet at the Sydney Airport Hilton on the eve of the contest for the conducting of the official draw for the opening round. It's an occasion that commands almost as much attention as the actual competition. The young hopefuls are particularly tense as they wait to learn which of the seeded surfers they've drawn for the start of the event. There's always a sympathetic murmur for those qualifiers who draw the big guns, like Richards and Horan, or Anderson and Kealoha, whose reputations alone are sufficient to dampen the spirits of even the most optimistic of their opponents. Each round will be sudden death, with the winner progressing and the loser immediately eliminated.
If a few of you could just stick around for a few minutes.
Because of the movable nature of Surfabout, competitors are requested to assemble each morning at Narrabeen and then travel to whichever of Sydney's beaches is offering the most suitable waves. This mobility not only ensures a constant variety for the contest, but an equal opportunity for all the surfers. Those who adapt the most readily are those that inevitably succeed. Prime requisite for any surfing contest is suitable waves. Those conditions were conspicuously absent from the Sydney coastline for the scheduled start of Surfabout. And after 3 days, it became imperative to find an alternative location. The south coast of New South Wales seems to offer the most likely prospects. And when word filters through that a break called Pipeline near Nowra is beginning to form up, the whole contest is hastily transferred to the spot.
12 past 6, more music, 2SM. Good day in Sydney, weather-wise, and hopefully a start to surf about.
One perfect day, we'll be out walking. Something is calling me. Whoa. This perfect day, I can't stop thinking.
The signs are a little more encouraging, but the decision whether or not to proceed is a marginal one. And yet again, the surfers are forced to wait impatiently for the powers that be to give their verdict. The waves at Pipeline are certainly acceptable in shape, but leave much to be desired in size, and offer little scope for the world's best surfers to show their skills. Inevitably, Pipeline is declared unsatisfactory, and the search goes on.
One perfect day, I'll get your telegram.
An isolated spot near Jarvis Bay, called Bendalong, is renowned for catching the southerly swell. After a short trek through the luxurious landscape along a rough bush track, the contestants at last receive a glimmer of hope. The beach break offers both a left and a right-hand wave, which provide an equal opportunity for all the surfers. That proves a deciding factor, and finally, it's announced the contest will proceed.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, made a decision. We're going to start the contest here today, and we'll be starting on the bank. As you see down in the middle there where Tommy Carroll is surfing. We're going to try and complete the whole round, first round today. If the nor'easter comes up, we'll probably move the contest up to a bank further here towards the north end. And to allow us the opportunity to try and complete the first round, we're going to reduce the heat time to 25 minutes.
Hawaii draws first blood in the contest through Hans Heidemann, the number 15 seed. Maroubra's Larry Blair is the first casualty and the first wild card to be eliminated. Defending champion Simon Anderson seems disoriented in the small waves, and only a last-minute tube ride keeps him in contention. Glenn Winton is unlucky. He leads Anderson until that final wave, and the Central Coast loses its lone representative. Michael Ho furthers the Hawaiian cause with a smart display against David Barr. Barr is far from disgraced, however. His third in the trials and his first taste of surfabout provide invaluable experience for the young Californian. Hot-buttered team rider Greg Day is regarded as one of the brightest stars on the Australian horizon, but his opponent turns in the finest performance of the day. The indomitable Hawaiian, Dane Kealoha, is the third seed for the contest, and he vindicates that assessment with an excellent all-round performance. Young Martin Potter displays the form that's catapulted him into prominence and is far too strong for Louis Ferreira. Joe Engel of Queensland is given a head start when Derek Hine commits a blatant breach of the interference rule and has to carry a zero in his wave tally. South Africa's Mark Price makes an auspicious debut in surfabout when he provides the major upset of the day. Previous winner, Buzzy Kerbox, the only Hawaiian, and indeed the only non-Australian ever to claim this title, is the first seeded surfer to be eliminated. Rookie Tony McDonough's aspirations receive a not unexpected jolt when he meets the reigning world champion. Mark Richards is supreme, and the number one seed carves his way gracefully into the second round. Two seed is not so convincing. Bondi Shane Horan is tentative and in a most uncharacteristic fashion catches only 8 of an allowable 10 rides. The uncertainty about the outcome of Horan's clash with Kevin Davidson is heightened when the Maroubra star finishes with an exceptionally high scoring wave.
We've just been handed the results of Heat 9. It's a very close heat, just winning by 3-2. And going through to the next round is Shane Horan. In second place, Kevin Davidson. Shane now advancing and Kevin being eliminated.
As Horan breathes a sigh of relief over the result of his first round heat, two of the remaining surfers prepare for a unique confrontation. For the first time in the history of a Grand Prix contest, two brothers have been drawn against one another in the same heat. Tommy Carroll is the ninth seed and justifies his favoritism for the clash with brother Nick. When he fires, Tom is a human dynamo. Not that Nick doesn't have the credentials, he's the defending Australian amateur champion and does his utmost to keep the Newport flag flying high. Jimmy Banks has bitter memories of his last involvement with surfabout. An afternoon nap in 81 caused him to forfeit in the second round. This time, his determination is obvious, as Steve Wilson can testify. The next heat matches two of the gentlemen of surfing. The unassuming Bobby Owens of Hawaii, who made his name in Australia last year with two outstanding wins in the Lightning Bolt and Quicksilver Trials. And the man whose style matches his demeanour, Narrabeen's veteran, Mark Warren. He's competed successfully against Bobby many times, but this time, the young Hawaiian prevails. Wes Lane continues to show the form that took him to victory in this year's Lightning Bolt Trials. But surfabout is a far different contest, and his opponent of a different caliber altogether. The Gold Coast legend, Rabbit Bartholomew, has been one of the most consistent surfers on the pro circuit since he won the world title in 78. His experience pays further dividends as he progresses to the second round. California's Joey Buran continues the charge by the seeded surfers as he twists and carves and turns his way to victory over wildcard Richard Cran. The highly rated Sean Thompson turns on his usual polished display to end the hopes of Hawaii's Tony Moniz. And Terry Richardson, who knows these South Coast breaks as well as any surfer in Australia, uses his local knowledge to advantage, ousting Mark Scott, a former world amateur champion. At the end of round one, it's obvious that the seeded surfers have adapted more readily to the bend-along waves than their would-be challengers. Only one seed has been eliminated, Hawaii's Buzzy Kerbox, whose failure is not completely unexpected. Buzzy's interests have diversified considerably since he won the crown only 2 years ago, and he's had to give serious thought to a reassessment of his future.
You can't surf forever, and you got to find something else that you can do. A lot of the surfers, I don't know what they're going to do when they can't surf on the contest anymore. But I've got a few options to me, and I'm going to go look into them and see what else I can do.
Round two of Surfabout is temporarily delayed as the tournament organisers wait hopefully for a low-pressure system to bring the contest back to Sydney. In the meantime, conditions at Maroubra have improved sufficiently for a start to a special women's event. Eight of the top Australian ladies have been invited to compete in their own contest, designed as a vehicle to provide them with further tournament experience, an essential ingredient if they're to have the same impact on the international circuit as the Australian males. Inspired after a highly successful series of special surf schools established by the co-sponsors of Surfabout, Radio 2SM in Sydney. At these courses, the majority of participants, surprisingly, were young women, one of whom, Pam Burridge, graduated to become Australia's women's champion. Wollongong's Jenny Gill is another outstanding individual in the women's ranks. Jenny finished fourth in a state school boys title recently, and not altogether unpredictably was the eventual winner of this event over Pam Burridge. During the women's event, a noticeable improvement in the swell holds promise of an exciting continuation of the main event, in which eight Australians, five Hawaiians, and three South Africans remain to resume their battle for surfing's richest prize. Surfabout resumes, but only after an interesting diversion, occasioned by the officials' frustration at the continuing poor quality of the waves on Sydney's beaches, and the tardiness of the promised change for the better. In a calculated gamble, they decide to head south once again, and it's all aboard the Bendalong Greyhound Express.
More music to SM.
This is George Moore at More Music 2SM, and Surfabout has really turned into something of a surfing safari. The world's top surfers are on the road and are again heading for the south coast in a surf break at Bendalong, just out of Nowra. I've got a song to play for the fellas on the bus. Here's Elton John.
Pilgrimage ends in disappointment as the expectant surfers are greeted with the frustrating news that the surf had been good until just before their arrival, when a sudden change in the wind had transformed the clean break into an unimpressive chop. Back to the buses and Sydney. The long delay continues, with its inevitable disconcerting effect on those remaining in the contest. Each day, they prepare themselves mentally for their most demanding performance of the year, harnessing their nervous energy and waiting. The tournament officials are forced to extend the deadline for the completion of the contest. But at last, the promised swell from the south begins to arrive at the Sydney beaches. When it reaches the 1 meter level, the decision is made to press on into the second round, with South Avalon eventually being chosen in preference to Cronulla. Simon Anderson makes an unhappy start to the day's surfing and reluctantly provides the first shock of the day. The small waves are obviously not to his liking. Hans Heidemann wins the heat unanimously, generating a lot more power from the limited opportunities. Martin Potter continues South Africa's demoralising assault on the Australian reputations. Queensland's Joe Engel is out-surfed, out-pointed, and out of contention. The clash of the Hawaiian giants, Ho and Kealoha, is of special interest in this round of the contest, with Kealoha vindicating his higher ranking. Mark Price has drawn the number one seed and tries valiantly. But Richards turns on a scintillating display in the fluky conditions and continues his charge into the quarterfinals. Jimmy Banks has a point to prove in his battle with Shane Horan. When he overslept in Surfabout last year, it was Horan he was scheduled to meet and to whom he had to forfeit the heat. Horan again has trouble with his wave selection and is severely restricted in the number of maneuvers he can perform. There appears very little separating the two. Horan finishes the heat looking far from confident and finds it difficult to conceal his anxiety as he waits for the judge's decision. The announcement produces a marked contrast in the reactions of the two surfers. Banks is ecstatic. Horan has been a major obstacle in his aspirations for the Surfabout title, and suddenly his prospects have soared.
Congratulations.
For Horan, losing is always a bitter disappointment, and he walks dejectedly from the beach.
I was really amped up and ready, ready to break walls and stuff, but no walls came through for me to break.
Horan's low spirits are matched by those of Simon Anderson. For someone who's enjoyed the unique distinction of winning Surfabout twice, there's only one way he could feel.
Yeah, I'm a bit upset, but I'd rather bomb out in this sort of surf. I'd be more upset if I bombed out if it was 6 foot and perfect, put it that way.
Back on the water, Bobby Owens and Tommy Carroll are fighting out a close one. Owens gives it all he has for Hawaii. Is equally determined, but despite the help of local knowledge, he loses the heat. Rabbit Bartholomew, the master tactician, advances the Australian cause with another solid showing. Terry Richardson's efforts deserve special mention. It came to light after the contest that he'd been surfing with a shattered ankle bone. Under those circumstances, an extraordinary performance. Sean Thompson, unhampered, registers a unanimous decision over the plucky Australian. After a testing day at Avalon, conducting the second round in waves that demanded so much of the contestants, the harried officials are beginning to wonder if Neptune is conducting his own personal vendetta against their contest. Small wonder, they're a little skeptical at the renewed assurances that far better conditions are on the way. As dawn breaks the following day at Narrabeen, there's almost an air of disbelief as a glorious sight greets the early morning assembly. The slightly eccentric reaction of the judges is indicative of their relief. D.Y. Point, with its irresistible offering of hollow rolling barrels, is immediately designated the venue for the day. And at the turn of the tide, one of the most memorable of all the Surfabout quarterfinal rounds gets underway. The first in the best of three confrontations matches Hawaiian against Hawaiian. Dane Kealoha versus Hans Heidemann. Kealoha takes it in two. Mark Richards' encounter with the young Martin Potter proves to be one of the most exciting of the day. Potter, with nothing to lose and everything to gain, throws caution to the wind. To hear the result. Heady news for the young newcomer. In one fell swoop, the 16-year-old Marvel has made an incredible impact on the whole of the surfing world. And from this moment on, his defeat of the reigning world champion will become an important point of reference for the rest of his career. Final number three sees Jimmy Banks take on Bobby Owens. Banks is dominant and powers his way into the semi-finals with consecutive wins over Owens. Quarterfinal number four represents a classic duel between two of the most respected stylists ever to grace a surfboard, Rabbit Bartholomew and Sean Thompson. After two superb heats, there's very little between them. Victory goes to Bartholomew. And so the field of 32 is finally narrowed down to the four semi-finalists. Dane Kealoha, Hawaii. Martin Potter, South Africa. Jimmy Banks, New South Wales. And Wayne Rabbit Bartholomew, Queensland. With a maturity that belies his 16 years, Martin Potter makes no bones about his intentions of becoming a future world champion. In view of his remarkable debut in Surfabout, it would seem his ambitions are not without substance. Mark Richards himself unhesitatingly endorses the young South African's prospects and credits him with the potential to reach the lofty heights to which he aspires.
I'd been surfing amateurs for quite a while, and I'd been surfing against the same guys over and over again. And it got kind of boring, so I decided to enter my first pro contest when I was 15. That was in South Africa. And the first one, I surfed against Sean Thompson and beat him. And I just thought, well, why not go on the pro circuit?
His resolve is about to face another stern test in the semi-finals, when Potter is to meet Dane Kealoha. The Hawaiian's charge has been steadily gathering momentum, and the sizable swell which has built up at Cronulla Point is obviously to his liking. The unlikely duo, the exuberant young novice and the seasoned campaigner, prepare for a do or die effort.
Gypsies ride through Wonderland. I took my horse down to the sand. Underneath a thousand miles of sky. Watched the waves come tumbling down. Heard so many different sounds. It cleared my head and eased my worried mind. Capricorn dancer, I'm
riding to shelter. Show me a sign, lead me on to the tropical zone.
Kealoha takes the first. Potter fights back brilliantly in the second, and a third heat is required to break the deadlock.
Diamonds scattered out to sea. The sun keeps laughing down on me. This crazy horse is trying to chase. Watch the waves come tumbling down, hearing all those different sounds. Just clears my head and ease my worried mind. Capricorn dancer, I'm riding to shelter. Show me a sign, lead me on to the tropical zone.
The judges consider their verdict long and carefully before deciding on a winner and announcing the first of the two finalists in this year's contest. For Potter, the decision means a temporary halt to his amazing progress. He retires, secure in the knowledge that his long-range plans are running way ahead of schedule. Kealoha is jubilant at his victory, which ensures his best result ever in the contest.
I don't know, something's been happening to me all through this contest, and like I said, you know, it's somebody up there is helping me to do this, and I just, you know, flowing with it, and I hope it just continues into the final.
Only one man now stands between Kealoha and the title. His identity will be known shortly as Wayne Bartholomew and Jimmy Banks prepare for the second semi-final. Bartholomew is conscious of the advantage Jimmy Banks has of surfing at his home break in front of a partisan crowd.
Jimmy's such a classic strategist. He's always in the right position. So there's one thing, he's not going to beat himself. I'm going to have to put on a superior performance to beat him, and that's as simple as that.
Bartholomew who wins the first heat, but Jimmy Banks draws inspiration from the overwhelming support of his home crowd and levels with a win in the second. It's another nail-biting finish.
First set, as we all know, it was Jim Banks winning 5-0. In the second set, Wayne Bartholomew won that one, 5-0. In the third set, and going through to the final of the 2SM Coca-Cola Bottlers Surfabout, Wayne Bartholomew winning 4 judges to 1.
Time is now of the essence, but in fairness to Bartholomew, a 30-minute break is allowed. He makes the most of the opportunity to loosen up and prepare himself physically for the demanding encounter ahead. Kialoa adopts a different approach altogether. By his own admission, the Hawaiian champion is more susceptible than most to the psychological pressures of competition at this level. The experts are guarded in their predictions.
Well, I think if it goes 3 sets, Rabbit Bartholomew will win. And I think if it goes 2 sets, Dane will win. I don't think Dane's got the staying power that Rabbit has. And he's got the brilliance, and if he can just pull it off in 2 sets, I think he'll do it.
Well, I feel it'll be very close. I think Rabbit has the strategy. Rabbit's incredible in those 3-set finals. I've watched him in a couple of the last couple of days, and he has incredible resolve when he loses the first one to come back in the second and the third. I feel Dane has a little bit of an advantage because he's had quite a long rest, and probably Dane has a few more explosive maneuvers than Rabbit has.
The tension mounts as the two protagonists prepare for the final act of their absorbing drama.
$2SM Coca-Cola Surfabout, winning a cash prize of $20,000, a world record, and the four-wheel dive Toyota Blizzard. Wayne Bartholomew is the winner of this year's Surfabout.
The Surfabout presentations have kept pace with the growing status of the contest, and the Siebel Townhouse is the setting for a glittering finale to the Australian Grand Prix circuit. It's a proud moment for Greg Day when the young Maroubra star is summoned to the dais and proclaimed the Rookie of the Year. Martin Potter and Jimmy Banks also received the plaudits of their fellow surfers when they received their prize money and trophies for equal third in the contest. Dane Kialoa is given a warm reception. The likeable Hawaiian is widely regarded as one of the most popular figures on the circuit. That, and a welcome check for $8,000, helped to compensate him for finishing second. But the ovation of the night deservedly belongs to Wayne Rabbit Bartholomew and his return to the winner's circle. For the Queenslander, it's a triumphant reaffirmation of his unfaltering determination and the end of a 9-year quest to win Surferbout. And so, Surferbout continues to pay tribute to its growing list of champions. The inclusion of this respected surfing ambassador among their ranks adds further to the luster of this unparalleled event in the world of professional surfing.